you for joining Insight with Insiders. I'm Julianne Bittner. Today we're going to shake things up a little bit. I have three esteemed staffing owners joining me from three different sectors of staffing in and different areas in the country. I thought it would be great to hear and understand staffing owners' perspective on a few areas: best practices from 2020, current challenges and opportunities, company culture and the role it plays in the success of their businesses, and lastly, what does the staffing industry as a whole need to do to work better with its clients? It gives me great pleasure to introduce our panelists. First on our list is Crystal Blackwell, CEO and staffing owner of Staffing One from Georgia. And she does federal government and in the private sector as well, in the executive administrative, accounting, procurement, and legal staffing. Good morning and welcome, Crystal.
Thank you, Julianne.
Next, we have Al Simon, CEO and owner of APS Solutions, American Professional Staffing Solutions. He is owner who just purchased the company late in 2020, but had 15 years with the company building that company from the ground up. So this company is located in Missouri, about an hour east of Kansas. He is placing industrial, energy, capital construction, renewable energy, and maintenance products. Welcome, Al.
Thank you. Welcome.
Next, we have Sergey Bogomolov, and he is right down the road from me in Chicago, Illinois, with Solve IT Strategies. He's celebrating 5 years as owner and CEO of his company. They started in 2016. They do IT, accounting, finance, and compliance. Welcome, Sergey.
Thanks so much. Yeah.
So let's start with the first question, and I'll throw it out to Al, because this related to best practices that came out of 2020. When we asked you this question, it's something I heard repeatedly throughout the year from the owners that I was talking to. So what were the best practices that you felt came out of 2020?
Oh, well, that's a good question. You know, there's several things I think that came out of 2020. I think the first and foremost is, you know, we're always planning, you know, and budgeting, but I don't think any of us plan for a rainy day as we saw in 2020, right? And so I guess the first thing is that we took is, you know, this could happen again, right? So you're never as good as you think you are. And so you got to plan for the times when it gets super lean. So the other thing that I think that we best business practice, you know, is as being recruiters, and as everybody probably knows, we always feel like with a cell phone, a laptop, you can work from the moon, right? So working remote didn't seem to be a big deal. However, over the course of several months, we realized that working remote was more detrimental to our organization than it was helpful. And granted, we know we couldn't go back due to COVID and whatnot, but I think that the best practice that came out is it allows us to now to mesh a kind of a flex schedule, right? Where the office is very important and you know, human collaboration is a big deal. But you know what, now you can still do your job from home if you have to leave at 3 or, you know, things like that. I think the other thing that came from it is the newer, younger employees that we had to send home to work remote struggled tremendously, right? Because there was no collaboration. There was nobody to lean on or learn from or hear, you know? So when we're back in our open environment here, you know, they can hear the guy next to them who's 10 years of seniority walk through or talk through situations where they were trying to figure it out on their own. So it's really enhanced our newer employees. And then the other thing, you know, working remote, it's very hard to hire new employees, especially if they have limited experience in your industry, because training them remotely is impossible. So we learned that, you know, we have to come up with, if we should go back to always having to work remote, we have to come up with some sort of training program to support new hires if we should go back there. And I think the last thing is working remote, a lot of our people suffer from social wellness, you know, and you know, we are in a people business, right? We collaborate with people, we're always around people. And so now to be kind of stuck in your house or your apartment for days and weeks and months on end and not have that human interaction, a lot of our people, you know, had some of that social wellness, you know, issues. And so, you know, we're coming up with policies and procedures on how to deal with that should we have to go back to working remote.
Very good. Interesting. Great information. Great concept. Yep. Crystal, your input.
For us, working from home actually became more productive. And I was the one that didn't work remotely, never have, but all of our team members have for well over 10 years, at least one day a week. Well, our building experienced COVID firsthand. We're in a building, in a 12-story building with about 1,000 people on any given day, and we were totally shut down. So we had no choice but to work remotely. And we found that it was much more productive. We got more done in less hours. And we also learned how to do time blocking so that if we had, for our VP, if she had a day of recruiting, she had it time blocked as exactly when she would do that. I do the same thing with sales calls now, so that I look a week out and say, okay, you're from 9 until 11, I'm going to time block and sell. And from 2 until 5, I'm going to do that. And then work in other things around that. So for us, and from what we're hearing from a lot of our clients, work from home and remote work became very productive. And now we're talking with clients as they're reopening. Some have reopened, but most are going to reopen after Labor Day, depending on what happens with the Delta variant. They're offering a hybrid model. And Julianne, any candidates or prospective team members that we're talking with now, first question is there a hybrid model for this assignment, or can I work fully remotely? So we'll continue to see that.
Interesting. Interesting. Sergey, what's your take on that?
Yeah, just to add a little bit on the remote culture, we have adopted a flexible model where our internal employees are free to choose when to come into the office and when to work from home. Some people like being in the office to get away from, you know, noises and distractions of the house, and others, you know, have dedicated areas. So flexible works. I would agree with Al that training new associates works a lot better in the office. So we typically do a month or two in the office where we can just kind of sit in the same room and, you know, bounce things off each other. And once the internal employee gets their railings, they start working on a flexible model. But I also want to get out of remote for a second. And if we're talking about best practices in 2020, I found that it's been widely adopted, and then there's been some challenges with this, but we immediately recognized that most clients are not going to be in the office taking phone calls. So cold calling was sort of dead for the year. So we engaged in some LinkedIn marketing, email marketing, but then of course, you know, everybody else also did. And so you have to stand out in that respect, and then LinkedIn imposed some restrictions nowadays. But I think our sales outreach is going to have to change as well. And it is towards more content marketing and adding value or providing value, creating value, similarly to kind of what we're doing here, right? So we're doing webinars, we're doing podcasts, we're discussing things which are important to our prospective clients. So we give, and then we ask one time versus cold calling, where we're sort of, you know, checking in and just asking for business. So I think just, again, we're becoming marketers versus salespeople on the sales side, and adding value with expertise. I also think another direction we're heading is, and that's something that we are defining within our firm, is becoming a narrower niche expert in a certain field. Versus being generalist firms. I feel like larger firms like Robert Half's of the world and such, they can afford to be more or less generalists. You know, small to medium sized firms like us, we I think have to become specialists in the field. So that's another practice that's coming out of this in order to stand out from the noise of, you know, different content that the marketers are flooding the market with.
Right. Excellent. Right. I agree. I felt that we had to differentiate ourselves even more by bringing more value, as you're saying, as in the podcast and that to the marketplace, and to show our customers and prospects that we bring more value by bringing more education and resource to the marketplace. So thank you. Excellent information. Let's move on to the next item. What opportunities and challenges do you foresee in the remainder of this year and beyond? It seemed like it's been a great kickoff to 2021. We saw the end of the fourth quarter, even the beginning of the third quarter, where it picked up in 2020 significantly in staffing. First quarter of 2021 was very strong. It kind of flattened out a little bit in the second quarter as unemployment came around again, federal unemployment picked up. So what are you seeing as your challenges and opportunities for the remainder of the year? And I'll start with Crystal.
I think that several things right now, as far as just challenges and opportunities, challenges for our clients, they're telling us they're trying to determine how to safely reopen their offices, whether it means retrofitting an office, or we've got one client that is going to basically have half of their team of about 400 work remotely for the rest of this year until they can do a retrofit. So lots of issues still around reopening and how to do that safely for your team. We're seeing, as I mentioned, a lot of clients that are telling us that they're going to be extremely flexible and whatever their team members want to do in terms of a fully remote schedule or a hybrid schedule, they're fine with that. Recruiting is challenging from everyone I talk with in every single skill discipline right now, because since February, Julianne, we've seen a record number of resignations and a record number of retirements like we've never seen. So I think we're going to have to continue to be creative in how we recruit and get the right talent for our client firms. And we're seeing a lot of job positions right now that are direct hire positions, more than I've seen in probably 10 years. And so I think that's going to continue for the rest of the year as companies continue to reopen and deal with either resignations or retirements.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Thank you. Sergey, what are the challenges and opportunities you're seeing?
Yeah, I think a massive opportunity, of course, also lies on the surface. Something we've all recognized is the ability to recruit nationally. We've seen a lot of candidates working from home in various parts of the country, something that our firm had sort of resisted initially when we focused on the Chicago market. We were forced into being comfortable and then genuinely became comfortable with recruiting talent out of anywhere United States, and we're placing them in clients all around the country. You know, we have clients in California and somebody's working out of their home in, you know, South Carolina or Virginia, right? So I think this will benefit everyone. It benefits us because we can make more placements, benefits the clients because they can get access to talent that they couldn't get before. Also benefits candidates because they can live a lifestyle they want, you know, so this shakeup, I think, is great. And we're continuing to take advantage of that. You know, challenges, of course, I agree with Crystal. We're seeing a lot of direct hire requests versus contractor. I think it's somewhat driven by the candidates and those with, you know, education and skills and desired competencies are less interested in contract roles. They're interested in stability. You know, a little bit of a shock from last year is still driving some hesitation. So we've adjusted for that, and we're you know, developing groups working on direct hire positions. But contract business is our primary goal. So we're also working a lot, kind of driving awareness of what's happening in the marketplace with the clients, small to mid-sized clients, which had don't use contractors or firms as frequently, so they don't necessarily know the realities of the market. So part of our way to add value is we consult with clients in their existing hiring practices. We advise them on what they could be doing to attract talent, whether it's with us or anybody else. I think there's a lot more opportunity coming out of the this recession than there is a challenge. Of course, there's going to be challenges, but anytime there's a challenge, there's a time to drive more efficiency, add more value, and grow.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Great. Great information. Thank you. Al?
So it's a good two-part question here. I think the challenges that we're facing, since we're a project-based, you know, contract company, supply chain has been a big issue in 2021, pushing most projects and start dates out so the customer can get their receivables. And not only that, everything seems to be costing more money now. So what our customers were bidding at one price is no longer that price because they can't get their you know, parts, materials, things at the same cost. So that's an issue that's hopefully going to work itself out, which ties into the other challenges. Anybody who's trying to hire people between $14 and $17 is running into the escalated unemployment benefits and whatnot, where they're doing the math. And if you're making $16 an hour, it's better to sit at home and lose $20 a week than get up and go to work, right, which is a huge issue, which also increases price on the supply chain. As far as the opportunity side for us, now we're seeing supply chain kind of ease up a little bit and projects are starting and the opportunities are becoming pretty significant, right? And so unlike my colleagues on this, so we're a project-based company. All of our jobs are out in the field and not at home. So we have limited ability to hire people to work remote or from their house or things like that, right? We build and operate power plants. And so with last year of everything getting pushed out and then the delay in supply chain, for us, the dam's about to burst, right? So we're trying to position ourselves to be ready to support our customers.
Interesting. Very good. Thank you. Very good. Great information. Thank you all. So what is working and isn't working to attract talent today, both for your internal and temps? I know we used to only hire temp to hire internally, and we are now doing direct hire because that's the only way we can get, you know, staff to be hired here. So we're one of those direct hire placements now for everybody else. What are you seeing that's working and not working in your organization, Sergey?
Yeah, so we've also embraced automation as an excellent tool. Now, of course, there's a caveat, right? A lot of us are receiving, and the candidates are receiving, automated emails that look like they're pre-populated and you know, very impersonal. You know, the days where a variable replaces your first name and that's considered personalization, they're gone, right? now it needs to be a lot more enhanced than that. So we're using some tools which actually use AI to analyze somebody's LinkedIn profile and add in sentences and paragraphs about somebody's career progression. And in other words, personalizing the outreach based on what the AI algorithm sees on their profile and or resume. So that's been great. That's one way to attract talent. Mostly that applies to the permanent hires because the recruiting cycle on this is much longer. The lead up time that's allowed is much longer. So we can use those tools. And then for temporary recruiting, just building your pipeline. And that's where specializing in a niche really comes into play, where you narrow down your scope of competency and you try to talk to everybody who has those skills and just have them in your pipeline for your clients to have. But if we need to be reactive and respond to requests for which we don't necessarily have a pipeline, just using a variety of tools like social media recruitment. And again, technology is so abundant these days, sometimes could be overwhelming, but there are aggregating tools which allow you to post your outreach on multiple social media platforms. And, you know, somebody sitting at lunch and checking their phone and, you know, all of a sudden they're seeing an ad that's relevant to them about a position that they were considering, or maybe they checked out your website and you're marketing back to them based on that. So tools like that on social media are working really well. We do very little now with the job boards and posting and hoping that a qualified candidate responds. Most of it has to be active outreach.
Okay, great. Thank you. Please comment both. I'm glad you commented on social media and job boards, because I'm hearing that a lot, that people are pulling away from job boards and doing more with social media. So I guess I would like to also find out if you're doing more with other social media tools besides Facebook and LinkedIn. Is it Instagram? Is it, I haven't heard much with TikTok at all, but I'm hearing people starting to look at that, which is interesting because that's a whole different concept. But mostly I've heard LinkedIn, Facebook, and of course, Twitter. So is that where you're mostly looking at, Sergey, on those three tools?
Yeah, TikTok we have not embraced yet. it's a generational thing. I just can't wrap my mind around how to. Who am I going to recruit there?
Right. I get it. Right. I think it has to be it's a different generation. So, yeah. Well, we'll see if Al's doing any of those things. Al, what's your concept on how you're trying to differentiate yourself in recruiting and what's working or attracting new talent and what's not working?
So unlike my colleagues here, you know, our marketplace is contract employment, right? So where they're seeing the switch from temp to perm or contract to perm only, we don't really see that because the market we're in, they're always going to be contract, right? They need 10 guys to show up for 8 weeks to go fix this. And after 8 weeks, this piece of equipment has to be back online and running, right? So they're never looking to make those people full-time hires, right? So with that in mind, you know, we do use all the job boards. We do use LinkedIn. We always have. I think for us, that the we have a robust database. And for us, referral system is really how we try to butter our bread, right? And so going to the web boards or social media is always the last because, again, we work in a niche market and a lot of people know good people. And that's how we start to build, you know. And so for us, we haven't found too much things that aren't working, right? The only thing that's not working is you know, it's very competitive, right? And so it's pricing and what we pay our employees, that's really the challenge now. And so, you know, we don't really play too much in the $14 to $17 range that I was talking about, but it's still, you know, everything costs more now, right? So when everything costs more now, people want to be paid more now, right? And so that's part of our challenge. You know, inside for our full-time people, you know, I go back to being in the office, right? For us to attract good people, and we're trying to get into the millennial market because that's where the future's at. I believe it's all about culture. And that's why coming back into the office, people get to breathe, eat, and live the culture. You know, working remotely, they don't get to see the other 20, 30, 40 employees, right? So there is no culture. There is no come be a part of us. It's like, hey, do you want to do the job? Do it well. Work from home, report to me, right? We'll track your starts or whatever you do, right? So that's very you know, static to us, right? And so it doesn't help breed that culture of excellence, desire, and want. And that's what we've really changed. So we also come from an industry, I call it, you know, the old school industry, right? It's just manufacturing, you know, it's everything you think of your grandparents and your grandparents' parents of how they went to work, right? And that's the industry that we started staffing in. And so we call that Neanderthal thinking now. So we're starting to be more creative, again, with flex time and great culture to break free from this, you know, punch the clock at 8, why are you 5 minutes late, to, you know, stay till 5 and punch the clock. We don't do any of that anymore. We believe that part of our culture is allowing younger people to be attracted to our organization.
Okay, great. Great information. Thank you. Crystal.
Like Sergey was saying, not using a lot of job boards. We have access, but we're seeing when we've used job boards, we've seen so much ghosting that it's just not worth the time and effort in it. Something that we've done for years, and Julianne, you know this, just because we've talked about this before, we do a reactivation mailer via email to all employees that have ever worked with us. And when you've got almost 25 years, that's a lot of folks. And just asking them who they know, we are repaying, again, referral bonuses. We've been doing that, believe it or not, since third quarter of last year for some of our more difficult to fill positions, particularly for legal and accounting. And one that we have, just a population we have used for years, are retirees. We have some strong advocacy in Atlanta in particular, and also in Birmingham with some groups, veterans organization in particular, that have referred just some fabulous retired military employees to us. And they have been a wonderful source, particularly for two of our major clients. And retirees right now, we're finding they played enough tennis and golf. They can't go shop every day anymore. They only have a small circle of friends, or maybe their bigger circle. They're ready to make some extra money. We can offer the flexibility that they need. And now with remote work, they can be anywhere and get these assignments completed. So it's worked very well. And then the last one for us is what we've done in the 36 years that I've been in the industry is plain old shoe leather. In Georgia, we're very fortunate that our state reopened last May. And because of that, I've been able to just have one-on-one meetings again with community groups, with churches, and just find out who out there, who is looking as far as making a career change at this point, who's retired, who may be coming into the workforce either out of high school or college at this point, and getting some great one-on-one referrals. And we're going to continue to market that and do that. So, that's what we're known for as a company. So.
Right. It's going back to some of that old school way. And I believe, you know, Al, you had said some of that in our conversations and with our staff when we talked earlier on, is some of it is you had to go back to the old school ways of having conversations again with people where we got away from some of that. And we found that is just picking up the phone and getting on, you know, we had to have calls with all of our clients constantly throughout last year, just to make check-ins and see how they were doing and can we help them and where do they need help? So it's going back to the old school ways again in some of it, even though technology has taken us away from a lot of that, you know. Let's talk about company culture. It's something that Crystal knows very well that I'm very passionate about. It's something that this company, it's who we are. It's what we take very seriously. And it's, I think it's why we've been successful for 32 years is because of our culture. And Al, I know you are very passionate about your culture as well. So I'm going to throw it to you first. What role does your culture have in the success of your business?
It's everything. I mean, it's the most important thing, right? So I believe that people don't work well under pressure, right? And you know, the scrutiny of pressure is probably a better way to say it, right? They still have to have deliverables and goals and the company has to make money to stay employed and all that. But there's a better way to disseminate that message. And so that we believe that's through culture. And as you can see over my corner, you know, we have a little basketball going here. I got a red stag out in the main room that we use as a ring toss. You know, we got a little putting green. So, you know, we got a TV and some couches. And so it allows people the flexibility of relaxing for a minute, having fun and still being serious and getting to work. You know, and then part of our culture, as we were talking about earlier, is get on the phone. We're going back to getting on the phone. And I know that technology leads you to a different way now because you can text people, you can have instant messages over that. There is nothing. Nothing can ever replace human interaction. That's what the culture, that's what we, you know, and so, you know, in today's environment, like people don't answer the phone anymore. They think you're a telemarketer. You're okay. Well, you text them first and say, hey, this is Al. I want to talk to you about a job in Kansas City. I'm going to call you in about 15 minutes, you know? And then once you break that ice and you get on the phone, then you start to have that human connection and you get people to buy into your culture now that they want to be a part of your organization and represent you. Because as everybody understands on this panel here, right? You send one of your employees out to one new customer and he doesn't do a good job. That customer thinks everything about your company is that one guy. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's so important to have your culture from your office permeate to all of your field employees.
Right.
Exactly. And to do that, you need every one of your full-time employees to believe in that too. So then they can transcend that message.
Exactly. Definitely. Crystal, I know you're passionate about culture.
That's, you know, our mantra is culture eats strategy for lunch. Yes. Mm-hmm. For years, we're extremely passionate about this. And I think now it's more important than ever that your team members realize they're part of a collaborative culture. They need to know that you want to hear them. More importantly, you want to listen to them. And we just continue to do that. And throughout this pandemic, we've reached out to every single team member we have across the country, because last year, for the first time in 24 years, I could not go physically see every team member. And Julianne's known I do this. I travel about 25% of my time, and we cover now 23 states. So you saw me at least once a year, or you saw our Vice President Tenero, one of the two of us, we're coming out to your site, and you knew we were coming. So that just the thing of a team member being valued, we know who they are, we know their families, we know if there are challenges. I mean, our whole goal is for our team members, we're working with you to further your career goals, with our clients to further their profit goals. So we're basically a conduit for that. We can't do that unless we know our team very, very well. And I think that's what's made a difference for us. And just like Tricom, we've got clients that have been with us ever since we opened our doors. And there's just a lot of gratification in knowing that these clients and team members know who we are. They know that they can pick up the phone, they can text us, or they can email us and have a conversation.
Great. Great. Thank you.
Can I ask you a question? Am
sure.
I allowed to ask her a question?
Sure.
So you said this is the first time in 24 years that you couldn't go directly see every one of your employees. Right. And that you're, but earlier on, you said that now working remotely makes you more efficient. And so culture is so big to you and talking to your people directly, but now they're all working remotely. Can you maybe just explain to me how you're more efficient now that you can't see all your people all the time and that you can't have team messages? They can only be individual messages, like, you know, when you're talking to a group, and maybe you do it on Teams, but I'm trying to just figure out the remote thing and effectiveness and not talking to people, which you may seem so important on the one-on-one to getting to know them, their families, and everything else.
As far as when I'm talking to my internal team, I still see my internal team as far as out, even though we've had to work remotely, we didn't have a choice about coming in the office. I've gone out to their houses, and like at Christmas last year, I showed up at each one and delivered holiday gifts and did things like that. When I'm talking about traveling to our team members that are on assignment at our client sites, last year was the first time that I could not do that because of COVID restrictions and because they were working remotely.
I gotcha.
And my internal team,
I gotcha,
much, much more productive. But I miss the coffee clatch, but they're getting so much more done. We've been amazed at the productivity that we've all had during this. But do I miss it personally? You better believe it.
Mm-hmm. Great. Thank you for clarifying that. That's great. Great question, Al. Thank you. Sergey, culture in your organization, the success of it.
Yeah, I think our culture is we love to have fun. We send out funny memes and, you know, and we joke with each other. And I feel like our culture is flexible in the sense that we're relaxed when we're doing sort of mundane tasks, sourcing, you know, planning, you know, using tools, sending out resumes and stuff like that. And we're, you know, we flex when we need to represent with the clients and with the candidates. But I feel like there are, our jobs are performance-based, right? Like in staffing, I'm confident everybody's paying commissions internally based on performance. So if you're not making commissions, you're obviously not enjoying the work. And vice versa. And then there are easier jobs to do for a base salary than staffing and recruiting. Mm-hmm. So my interviews with internal candidates are almost in reverse. I usually start by telling them about myself, about the company, what we need. And then I let the person interview me. I'd like for the internal candidate to learn everything possible about our firm, about me, about our peers, about the job, to make sure that it's the right fit for them, that they're going to wake up in the morning and instead of texting their friend saying, hey, I hate this, it's Monday, I got to go to work, that they would be excited to go to work. And I don't want the internal candidate to necessarily nail the interview with me and say the right things and, you know, question them. I can hire them without an interview today. And if it's not the right fit, I'll fire them tomorrow, right? So one of the mentors that I respect had said, hiring is guessing, firing is knowing. And it, I don't, you know, sound like a cliche, but it stuck with me so well that, you know, no matter how the interview goes, we're going to evaluate performance when the person starts. So what I try to do is accelerate that and have that conversation at the interview instead of the first day on the job, right? What's expected of you and then interview me just to let me tell you honestly what, you know, your life is going to look like. And so most of the time we attract similarly minded talent internally using this approach. And I love it. And then when we're talking about the work itself, I think that personal well-being of our internal employees comes first, their family well-being second, you know, our clients and candidates third. If somebody's sick, if somebody's not feeling well, if somebody just didn't have enough sleep during the week, I send them home. I tell them to take a nap. I tell them, you know, we have a couch in the office. We have a nap room. People can take naps whenever, right? So sometimes 15 minutes, half an hour lets you reset. I want people to be happy and productive. That's number one thing. And if I tell them, if I ever fall short of being, you know, the best boss you've ever had, tell me. I promise not to retaliate. I promise to, you know, take reasonable feedback and take reasonable actions to fix that. I want people to be happy at work. Again, there's obviously productivity, and I'll be honest, if somebody's falling short, and they know that, there's going to be direct and conversations, and maybe sometimes they're not pleasant to hear. But if we have our customers and candidates' interests in mind, you know, those are the nature of the conversation. But with all of this together, I feel like our staff, you know, feels great, and they feel motivated to perform, you know, and little things like bonuses and perks outside of their normal commissions and bonuses always work really well. And then my philosophy is giving our staff autonomy to make mistakes, and then discussing those mistakes if they do make them, right? So there's no retaliation. We discuss mistakes, we grow. But then what happens is that if the decision that they've made on their own is fruitful, right? It's their entire win entirely. They don't have to share it with anybody. They feel good. So things like that. The other thing is it's kind of going back to some of the tools, and I forgot to mention it, but I think I agree with Al that we need to be on the phone. We need to be talking to our clients live and on phone, on Zoom and stuff like that. However, I also think that automation can increase our phone time with the clients. For example, one of the specific tools we use is a bot that has its own email. It's like a virtual assistant, which schedules phone calls for us with the candidates who had expressed interest. And so once you kind of build a campaign for the outreach to your candidates and they respond positively, in the background, the candidate gets an email from a virtual assistant who has a name, right, has an email, and talks to them about scheduling a conversation back and forth. This is especially important for some of the direct hire roles where your candidates might be working, and just a cold call from nowhere, unscheduled, might not go all that well. But if you schedule the call and the system works, then each internal associate has a calendar full of invites to speak with potential candidates. And then you are on the phone, you're speaking to them personally, you're just automating the mundane task of going back and forth, trying to figure out when it would be a good time to talk. So that's really cool. People love that. And that's my bit.
Wow, interesting. Thank you for sharing that. I have to agree with you on your interview approach. I do the same thing. I did an interview yesterday and I was very honest with the candidate and said, I'm going to explain to you what the culture's like and what our expectations like, so you really understand the business. And I said, you know, at the end of the day, my goal is, if it's not for you, then I get it if you say no to the business opportunity, because it's not for everybody. It's a high-paced environment. It's high customer service. I'd rather you say no than say yes to the environment and realize that it wasn't a good fit. We want a win-win on both sides. So I was trying to just be really honest with her. And she's like, no, this is exactly what I'm looking for. But so I take that honest approach of really expressing who the company is, how we operate, the fast-paced environment it is. And so that if it's not for everybody, I get it. That's perfect, you know? So thank you everybody for sharing that. Let's go on to what I think is really important is, what is the staffing industry as a whole? Each of us, as you owners of a business in the staffing industry, have to do to work better with the clients, with your clients. Sergey.
Yeah, I think staffing industry is moving in the right direction overall. I think for a while we sort of suffered from a reputation of being salesy and perhaps a bit of a nuisance, right, with a lot of cold calling. I think as a whole, we're realizing that we need to be truly embracing a niche, becoming an expert in our field and advising our clients before we ask for the business. That I think is the term I'm looking for is specialization. So specialization is definitely a strategic direction I feel everyone should embrace. For the benefit of our industry as a whole, I also think we need to educate our clients on how to work with us. Because many times we face a client who will demand certain terms on agreements and on projects, which we find are below market. We also find that a lot of times the competitor that proposes those terms will not deliver on those terms. Typically, you know, lower fees or short conversion schedules, different things. In other words, that result in below market compensation to the staffing firm. Usually it's a junior sales rep from a competitor who's hungry, who needs a deal, will go into a client and agree to the, you know, below market terms. And then they'll go back to the office and they'll be laughed out of the recruiting room because the it's a candidate's market right now, and clients should realize that we very much have to, you know, pay our candidates well. We have to be a partner for them. Our recruiters have to be compensated well for the work that they're doing. And when we educate the clients on what the realities are and how we also scorecard our clients, I feel like our clients deserve to know. And very rarely do the clients know what happens in the recruiting room, in the delivery room of our internal offices, where if we have an order for a Java developer and we find one and we have three clients and working with one client is profitable, easy, we have direct communication with the manager, we have feedback. Sometimes with our best clients, we have a shared Slack channel where we can instantly submit candidates and chat with the hiring manager and get, you know, real feedback, real time. We know that this is a productive time for us. It's productive for the client. It's productive for the candidate. Those clients are going to get the best terms, you know, and if the client says, hey, I need a Java developer, we want to pay half the fee and we're going to get back to you in 3 weeks, or we're going to get back to you when we get back to you, right? And then they get back with a rejection and no feedback. We need to educate our clients and let them know that this is not acceptable and it's unproductive. It's not because we want something. It's because we want to be productive. We want to fill roles and move on. And I feel like as an industry, we should push back and we should educate and we should let the clients know how this works. When that happens, clients understand the importance. They see us as a partner. They value our bottom line. They value our time. They value their time. So everybody wins. Candidates get jobs faster. We're profitable. Clients fill their roles and move on.
Great. Great. Thank you. Crystal.
Totally agree with Sergey. And one thing he said, business partnership, totally, totally agree with that. And I think we as an industry need to work with our clients to ask them to communicate more, particularly when it comes to their culture. And when a client can't define a culture, we're going to walk away from it because we can't communicate that to our team members to get that right fit. And that's just, to us, is critical. The expectations, defining the expectation and asking them why our team members should work for them. What's the sizzle about that? And yeah, it's going to be a lasting relationship there. We're not a one and done, never have been. We're looking at a long-term relationship with them. And one of the questions that we're going to ask up front that we feel like all staffing firms should be doing this, and they don't. And to Sergey's point, we see a lot that come and go. We have in our 25 years. Why? If we're talking with you, what has to happen in, say, 3 to 5 years for this to have been a productive partnership? Define that for us. Tell us about your strengths. Tell us about the opportunities. Tell us about the challenges you're having so that this is a win-win for both of us.
Great. Thank you. Al?
No, they both have very good points. Every time I think our industries aren't aligned, you know, they say things like that, which makes, you know, the staffing industry pretty much all the same. But, you know, I agree with both of them. I think that educating your customers or your business partners, as we all call it, is key. Understanding your role in the relationship, though, right? We don't own the product. We don't own the deliverable, right? We're always second in line. And so when you're second in line, some people have an air of arrogance where they treat us like the redheaded stepchild, right? Like, you know, you're a dime a dozen, right? I give you a job order. You make one phone call. You got your one candidate. So easy. Like, what's the big deal, right? And you're like, well, if it was that easy, everybody would do it, right? So educating your customer on what, you know, Sergey said, is it takes a lot of time, energy, and effort to identify the right person. Sometimes you get lucky and find them right away, right? But, you know, I think that they don't understand that with the lack of feedback, that they're hurting their own reputation, that they're hurting our reputation. You know, it's like, Mr. Customer, I know that you think that our guy thinks it's APS, but we did tell them we're recruiting for you. And the fact that you don't give them any feedback, they sit for 4 weeks, 5 weeks without, they're never going to come work for you directly anyway, right? So to get them off of that, you know, the business partner of it and get off the redheaded stepchild, you know, I think that to Crystal's point, you know, we've fired several customers, right, that just can't get in line with the way we want to deliver our package. You know, our motto is investing in people, right? And not providing people feedback is not investing in people. It's not the right thing to do, right? So we keep pounding that we always call everybody back whether they got the job or don't get the job. But some customers who never let you know, you just keep calling your guy back and being like, they haven't told us anything. We're assuming after 4 weeks, nothing. You know, and so it's a hard place to be, right? So when you finally get to a place with a customer after years of developing and they come to you and they believe in the solution, the value you're providing them, it's a great place to be. I think we all still work with new customers too, where you get a job order. And one of the questions we always ask our salespeople is, how many other people have you given this job order to?
Yeah.
Right. So if we're one of 10 companies, you know, we're not interested because it's a rat race now. Right. It's the first guy to find the first guy who's, you know, walking, breathing, eating that kind of hits your buzzwords. Right. We're not interested in that. There's no value in that. So If you want to take us to market with everybody else to beat us up on price. Right. So I always tell them, here's what happens. You're going to beat us up and make our price go down because you got four other guys proposing it too. Right. Then we're all going to find one or two or three ideal candidates. We're all going to talk to them. And when they find out I talk to them, you're going to offer them $2 more. Then the next guy's going to offer them $2 more. And then eventually your price is going to come down and the pay rate's going to go up. And then there's no value or margin. So it's informing your customer that they even actually lose on that that type of watering down the opportunity to 20 different agencies is a lose for everybody. So that's the challenge we have is gaining their trust to allow us or maybe one other, competition's always good, or one other firm to work on it where you can actually truly provide value.
Alan, it's like you said, it's not about us or our desires. I think at the end of the day, if we step back and we explain to our customers that the time value of a vacant seat that they have continues to grow, I guess, and have a negative impact on their bottom line if they don't have a person in the seat.
Yeah.
If they're continuing to negotiate terms which might have a much lesser magnitude compared to the opportunity cost of not having a filled seat. Let's fill the seat. Let's get the qualified person, in the seat as soon as possible. That's our goal. And then how do we get there? Then we talk about how many competitors we have. Maybe, you know, an exclusive is great, but it may not be even, you know, the best solution for the customer. And sometimes we tell the customer that we might say, hey, you know, if you want to call one or two other firms, we're fine with that. You know, probably no more than that. Right. So then if we're financially motivated, we're going to prioritize the position. You know, the recruiters are going to prioritize the position and send the best candidate to you versus somebody else who demands, half the
you got it.
Terms. And then everybody wins. And then protecting, you touched on protecting the client's reputation. This is massive. I don't think clients realize that when they're working through an agency, like you said, that it's their reputation, the client's reputation. So timely feedback, detailed feedback, candidates love it. They talk about it. If they had a good hiring experience with the company, they'll tell their friends.
Mm-hmm. Great.
I agree. You know, I think the other challenge that we have too is that, you know, they don't understand the cost that we have to go search on something that never goes anywhere, right? Because we're still paying our recruiters and our account managers and all that. And so I always tell my customers that too, because I have this old analogy, anything that's free has no value, right? So when they call us up and say, hey, go find me a guy with A, B, and C, they have no skin in the game. They got no money in the game, right? So it's free to them. So whether they use it or don't use it, they don't care. And that's the point of, hey, look, this, we do have skin in this game here, right? So we'll give you one time to spin us up, maybe twice, and then we're done, because it does affect our bottom line. And we do tell our candidates again that it is your organization that is, you know, the start of this, right? We didn't make up the opportunity. You obviously called us, or we called you and said, yes, you have a need. Mm-hmm. The other thing I'd like to end it on too is educating our customers on how terrible VMSs are. You know, I think that HR kind of stirs the drink, and some customers think, you know, HR people think, well, if we hire a contracting or a consulting company, we're not doing our job, or the organization is devaluing us, right? And that's one of it. The other half is the VMS where, you know, submit all your candidates into this black hole, and eventually we may or may not pick one of your guys, and you're never going to hear anything else. And I'm like, well, you know, that doesn't work. Like, I could count on no hands how many VMS customers we have, because we refuse to work on those. And even good customers we used to have that went to the VMS, they call us up and say, how are you working on us anymore? I'm like, because I'm sending my best candidates to the customers who pay the best, who reward them the best, and don't have this black hole. And one day you'll give up the VMS, or you won't, and you'll just keep running down this rabbit trail of terrible candidates because nobody wants to work with that anymore. And I may just be us, but I like to hear what Sergey and Crystal think of VMSs.
No, Crystal, I think you have the kind of the same opinion of a VMS.
We worked with one for several years, and Al, to your point, communication to us is critical, and we didn't have that any longer. We just gracefully walked away and just said, you know, this is not a fit for both of us anymore. And it's, the irony of it is the person that ran that VMS is now one of our clients with his own firm. You never know. You never burn a bridge because you never know.
No, I didn't say burn a bridge. We just don't work. I agree with you. That's awesome.
The other thing I think that's interesting is if we work with an MSP / VMS that is well run, we love it. If it's not well run, then we hate it. But we also have begun to kind of build relationships with the MSP reps and understand maybe why the system is not working. And a lot of times it has to do with the adoption of the MSP program by the end client. And if the end client doesn't have faith in the program and that the program will deliver good candidates in a short period of time, the program doesn't work. So what we began to do, we began to offer our time to present to the internal stakeholders at the end client and talk about our capabilities as members of the program to essentially help the MSP sell the program and drive user adoption within the client. So it serves a few purposes. You obviously build goodwill with the MSP. You help the client adopt the MSP / VMS. And I, in theory, and sometimes in practice, ideally everybody wins.
Yeah, that sounds good too, because you're educating, you know, you're making their problem your problem to try to, you know, achieve a goal. But the thing is, you're also educating them to use any of your competition too, right? So I don't disagree with you, and that's great. And if you're making strides with that, then keep doing it. You know, we just figured it was better, you know, money value of time for us, right?
Yeah. Or
value of time for, you know, so that's good though.
Well, and Sergey, in your industry, there's a lot of MSPs in your industry, as in healthcare as well. It's just flooded with MSPs and VMSs. Yeah. Well, great information. Thank you all. I'm going to close with one last question, and that is if anybody has any words of wisdom they would like to share with our listeners. Crystal, you have 25 years running your company. Sergey, you have 5 years with your organization. Al, I know your organization is new, but you actually started from the ground up with it. So you have over 15 years with your organization. We've gone through a lot of ups and downs through the economy, through some other industry. You know, we just had a pandemic. We've also had 9/11. So we've gone through a lot, the industry. Any words of wisdom you would like to share?
I just think collaborate. And I think that's the thing where I've seen our industry shift so much. If we were sitting down 20 years ago, we would not have had a candid conversation like this. And I think we're seeing it across, you know, our national staffing organization, ASA, and so many others now, where it's so much more of a collaboration and truly looking at best practices. So mine would be just simply encourage and continue discussions like this, where we can help someone else, we can inform, we can bring challenges to the table and say, okay, how can we do this and do this better? So I think just continuous improvement now. And I personally love seeing that in within our industry, because we're very blessed in that we get to touch every single industry in this country. We're one of the key leading economic indicators. And typically we see a recession a year before anyone else does. We come out of a recession 6 to 9 months before anyone else does. So that's the part for me that's a lot of fun. And clearly in our industry, nothing is constant but change.
Right, exactly. Thank you, Crystal. Great information. Al, go ahead.
I was going to say, continue to have fun. This we're in the people business. And I'd like to use an example as a shout out to one of my staff, Jen Schuster. She's fantastic as a human being, but what makes her unique is she really cares about the customers. She may not have necessarily subject matter expertise when we're talking about specific requirements. And she asked me at one point, she says, what's my value proposition? How do I give, give, and give before I ask? And I thought about it, and it seems that a lot of our clients are also stressed when they're looking for talent. They're also stressed when they're negotiating terms with staffing partners. They're stressed all the time. And if you can brighten their day, if you, with a joke, with a song, with that, she sings into people's voicemails, she sends them funny pictures. And I go, listen, you just made their day a little bit easier on the front end. Of course, we will deliver professionally on their requirement, but you made their day better, right? So that's your value proposition. You know, that's how you pay forward, and then you ask for the business. So it's just one example, but there's ways to be creative in the ways in how you deliver value before you ask for the business. Have fun.
Great. Thank you, Al.
So I'm going to leave it with this. I think that the staffing industry's future is bright. And I base it off of a couple of things, but I think first and foremost, I think most millennials, a little bit over millennials, want to work contract now because they saw what happened to their parents and their grandparents, of their pensions going away, of things getting bled out that they thought was going to be their retirement. So everybody's like, I want all I could get right now. And so the only way that really works is through staffing, right? Through a contract company, as Sergio said earlier, that it's a candidate's world right now. And that's because they want it now. They're not going to go hire direct anymore because, hey, okay, your 401k is good. So you stop making money. Then I don't even know how to get my 401k out. No such thing as a pension anymore, right? So I want to get my maximum value today. And if that's the market of the candidates, then we are the conduit to make all that happen. And I believe that I believe more people will be working through agencies in 10 years than they will direct hire.
Great. Great information, guys. I thank you very much for being so candid, for sharing all your information, your knowledge, your expertise. I appreciate it. It's been great. I went longer than I thought, and I loved it. I thought it was great. I appreciate it. So I'm going to end the recording now. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.